Hello, friends. Before we get into today's episode, I wanted to talk to you guys a little bit about transportation. I know for me, when I go to the airport, I hate waiting on those long security lines and just sitting in the airport and the flight might be delayed. It takes forever. But you face the same problems when you're going on a train or when you're driving a car and you're sitting in traffic. It's just such a pain in the ass. So the solution to that would be walking. Walking is the way of the future and the way of the past. Lots of people use walking. Take Dennis Quaid, for example. In the movie The Day After Tomorrow, he walked from Washington, D.C. to New York City in no time, and it was a new ice age. So, when you're thinking about going on a long trip, try walking. It's gonna take a long ass time, but you might feel better about yourself. But if walking is not your thing, I can't stop you from taking airplanes, going on trains, driving a car. But I tell you, you're gonna feel better about yourself if you just put on those walking shoes and just see where the road takes you. See where your feet take you.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, to the Poncho section. Today's episode, we talk about streaming services. Please enjoy.
I don't know. It's been a crazy week.
Yeah?
And just with everything, like today, even at work, it was like, we had the fire alarm go off.
Oh my god, my workplace too.
Yeah.
What's going on?
And the thing just kept like beeping and they kept going on like the loudspeaker saying like there's a leak in the first floor. Engineers are trying to figure out. I don't know. Everything's been going on lately, especially with this train crash this morning. It's like
man, you need world's falling apart.
I don't like being out in the world anymore. I like being I like being home and I like watching shows. You know, I like watching TV.
Excellent segue.
It's a great segue, and it's a good escape because for me, I don't have cable.
Yeah,
and I think most people nowadays don't have cable.
Yeah, so pretty much.
We're watching pretty much all the streaming services.
Yeah,
you know? And it's cable's not something I miss. I go to my parents' house and I flip through channels, and there's commercials,
mm-hmm.
and there's movies that are edited. I just watched 21 Jump Street, I think it was, and the movie was edited.
Yeah.
So it's stupid. And when you watch things on, you know, any of the streaming services, it doesn't have any of that. You forget that.
Yeah.
I never feel like I miss cable. I'm always just bouncing around and finding shows.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know about you, but I have one show at a time.
Okay.
I don't usually do maybe two sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
If it's like one's like a comedy and one's a drama.
Right.
But normally I only have one show. That I follow at once.
I feel like I'm the same way. Either I'm doing one show.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Carr.
Yeah.
Either I'm doing one show, or if it's like you mentioned, a drama and a comedy. So
yeah.
Although I guess it doesn't really fit into this because it's HBO, but
HBO definitely fits into this.
All right, then HBO fits because it was that whole Game of Thrones, and then that would follow by Silicon Valley.
Yeah.
So that's kind of like, I guess, a good example where.
Yeah.
Drama and comedy kind of together, and that's two shows.
Well, I think HBO definitely fits in because I think HBO is really the top because mm-hmm. I feel like they're the first network to adapt well to the new mm-hmm. model where they came out with, well, first they have a partnership with Amazon now.
So I
believe some of their shows, at least older shows, are on Amazon.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
But they also have HBO Now,
mm-hmm.
which is its own service.
Yeah.
And which I didn't realize until recently, you can watch the HBO Now shows in real time, like when it's airing mm-hmm. on HBO. Whereas with HBO Go, you have to wait until the show's over. Not that it's a big deal.
Right.
So it starts right after the show ends. That makes sense.
Is that correct? Because I feel like I've watched Game of Thrones when that came out.
Well, like, Game of Thrones is on, what, like 9 o'clock?
9, yeah. So I think I would watch it at 9.
You would? Okay,
yeah.
I don't know. I thought it was that at 10 o'clock you could watch
the
it.
The one thing I think it might be the difference is the HBO Now, I think, has all of the HBO stuff.
Yeah.
And I believe HBO Go has just a select
HBO Go has a lot, though.
It has a lot. Oh, yeah. It definitely has a lot. But I think it's more selective than HBO Now. I feel like HBO Now has more options. That's my guess. I don't really know.
I've never used HBO Now.
Yeah.
Because I use HBO Go.
Yeah.
But HBO Now would be its own service.
Right.
I think it costs like $15 a month mm-hmm. or something like
that. If my parents ever get HBO Now, then I will watch it.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is how I'm watching HBO Go.
Yeah, yeah.
Thanks, Mom and Dad.
I'm pretty much on the same boat. Well, they use my Netflix account, so
okay.
I think think we kind of, it's not even at all, because cable's super expensive. Yeah. My Netflix account costs like 10 bucks a month.
It's a better trade-off than what I got. I'm just a leech.
Yeah.
I don't provide any service for my parents.
Well, they keep asking me about, you know, how do we use Amazon? It's like, yeah, I have an account. I'll show you how to do it.
Yeah.
It's like this whole thing. My mom's like, I don't know how am I going to do this? It's like, I'm like, I'll show you how to do it. But anyway, what shows are you watching right now? On anything.
I just watched some episode of New Girl for some reason the other day.
But is there any?
But it's not a Netflix original.
Yeah, well, what, like, are you watching any, like, are you into a show right now, like, where you're like, following it?
Yeah, unfortunately, I think I've kind of run out of shows. Like, I was watching, I got all caught up on Shameless.
Okay.
On Netflix. Every single time Orange is the New Black comes out, I watch that one.
Right.
For some reason, I don't know why, they took Doctor Who off of Netflix.
Really?
And I'm a big Whovian, and I don't know why they took it off. And
BBC America.
Yeah.
That's where it is.
Yeah. And then, unfortunately, I mean, not that this has anything to do with, like, Netflix, but for some reason, they're, like, not doing a season this year. I'm going to have to wait an extra year for there to be a season.
Oh, really?
Yeah. What the hell, Moffat?
That's a huge bummer.
Yeah.
Well,
but what about you? What are you watching?
Right now, I'm actually watching Transparent.
Oh, yes.
And that's the first series I think I've actually watched on Amazon Prime.
It's great.
It's really good. So yeah. I'm in season two. But see, the problem I'm having, and I really like the show, but because I was thinking today about the difference that, you know, Amazon, Netflix, and I guess Hulu too, they all have the same thing where they release maybe somewhere between like 6 and 13 episodes of a show, and they release it all at once and you can binge watch it. Whereas HBO still has the week to week kind of thing.
Right.
So I was thinking, like, what's better? And I was like, okay, it's cool to have everything there at once because you can kind of breeze through it at your own pace. But the downside, there's a few downsides to it. First of all, with me, when I go through a show too fast, I feel like I forget things easier.
Okay.
So if I'm not like watching, like, I can't like think about the episode and you know, I go from one to the next and then maybe I forget something that happened.
Right.
So that's one thing. Second thing, which happened to me recently, is people will spoil things for you. So I try not to mention when I'm watching shows.
Yeah.
Now everyone knows I'm watching Transparent, and hopefully by the time this comes out, I'll have finished the series.
Okay.
But I'll be all caught up. I think there's 3 seasons.
I honestly don't remember which season I'm up to. But I'm definitely watched all of the first season.
Okay. I mentioned it to someone and they immediately spoiled something for me.
Oh, no.
But not even thinking about it. Like, oh, this happened. Like, yeah, but that happens in season, like, that I discover now happens in the next season versus the one before. I was like, and I specifically told you I'm in the first one.
Oh, no.
So, and you see things, and especially now online, if you Google something about the show, like, you might get spoiled.
Yeah.
So everything, because it happens so fast, someone is going to watch it faster than you.
Yeah.
And for me, like, reading, it was like, if it reminds me of, like, when I used to read the Harry Potter books, and someone would read them faster than I would, and then would spoil them for me. Now, with TV shows, you only had a certain amount, like, the next one wouldn't come out yet. So
right.
you had a certain amount of time. Now they're all out at once, can be spoiled. That bothers me.
Those bastards.
Yeah, so while there is that advantage, I do kind of like that HBO is sticking to that week-to-week model, and I hope they don't change it.
Yeah.
I hope they keep it. And I think they will keep it.
All right.
I think it's kind of what separates them. It's what they try to be original, because they're not TV, they're HBO. So
yeah.
They have to be their own thing.
Sure. Well, I mean, I really like Transparent. And I like how, like, Netflix, Hulu, Amazon Prime, those kind of guys, how they're doing their shows, but they're doing it. The shows, I guess, do have, like, an HBO kind of feel to it, where it's an hour-long kind of show. It's not like with regular TV where there's needs to be breaks, and I think they call it like a false cliffhanger. What's with all these trains and cars passing by? I think they call it like a false cliffhanger, where they have to have something kind of sort of exciting happen right before each commercial to make sure that you come back. Where with these kind of shows, since it's like about an hour long, they can have the whole episode kind of building and building and building till one kind of like really great kind of like oh my god moment, basically.
Yeah. Well,
and then that'll bring you to make sure you stick around for the next episode.
Yeah, well, it almost reminds me of like a movie trailer. where like someone turns around like, oh my god, it's blah, I'll see this in you know, in October. You know, it's, it's just it's really annoying and cheesy.
What I'm saying is, like, I like that they're able to build and, like, you're able to grow and get, I feel like, into a deeper story in an hour-long kind of episode as opposed to a half-hour episode that, or I guess they're kind of, a lot of those shows are maybe, like, 20-something minutes because they have, like, a few minutes for breaks, but, like, on TV. Yeah. But, like, for, like, a Netflix show or an Amazon Prime show, you have, like, a whole hour to watch some event go on. And I feel like it gives you a better sense of development of what's going on, better grip of who the characters are and the events.
Yeah, well, you can argue now that TV is better than movies because of the way, like you were saying, how things kind of go from one to the other. You don't need those breaks.
Yeah.
So there is that nice flow. And also, they have a lot of time. There's so much more time they can use to, like, develop these characters. Absolutely. They don't feel rushed. Yeah. So I feel like that's good. And it's like a good sweet spot. Because none of these shows, I don't think any of the... I could be wrong, but I don't think any of these networks do a season that's longer than, like, 13 episodes. I feel like that seems to be, like, the max.
Yeah.
And I feel like that's really good. Because if you watch a network show, like... on NBC or something, there's like 20 plus episodes of those shows. Yeah. That's a lot. That's a big commitment. It's a big commitment for you. Mm-hmm. It's a big commitment for the actors because they can't do anything else.
Right.
They can't, they're like, you're in that show. And I mean, if you find time to do something else, like, good luck. I mean, you're going to get paid a lot of money, but you're in it. You're in a contract. And then eventually the writing staff is... I mean, there's only so much they can do until they're just like, fuck it, filler. You know, it's really hard to keep that consistent. And I was thinking about this with, like, the show Lost, which I really liked. But eventually it got really bad. And I was like, if Lost was maybe, I mean, maybe if they had cut down a season, they'd taken away, like, the last season, that would have been great. But if they hadn't had, like, 20 episodes a season, if they had only 10, maybe, like, 13. I mean, maybe it would have been a better show.
Maybe, yeah.
Like, it would have been a little... They could have taken out all the crap that they didn't need.
Yeah, and the thing that's interesting is... I mean, I don't know. Some shows they do... Maybe they'll have, like, a topical kind of thing going on. And maybe they'll write each show... Like, each episode is kind of, like, a few weeks out, and then they write it. And a few weeks out, they write it. With, like, these type of shows, it seems that they have everything laid out all at once, and you have the whole thing into a package. So they know what's going to happen from beginning to end. Yeah. And sometimes I feel like that you get a better product with that, where maybe you have less plot holes or missing information than those other, like, half-hour regular TV shows.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to know, because a lot of shows do that, where they have, like, a whole idea and they know how it's going to play out. And then a lot of them don't, where the writer, they're just kind of discovering as they go along. Yeah. I know it was like that with Breaking Bad. Breaking Bad, they didn't know.
Oh, really?
They had like a general idea, but they were kind of figuring it out as they went along.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, which is kind of cool.
That's impressive. Well, my theory.
Well, they knew. Well, no, but I think they knew how long the show was going to be. I think they, like, knew it wasn't going to go on past a certain point. They had, like, certain things figured out.
Right.
Like, you know certain stuff. But along the way, there were things they figured out. Like, hopefully people have seen Breaking Bad at this point. This is from a few years ago.
Yeah.
So...
I feel like we've passed the...
If you haven't seen it, you can shut the podcast off and and then come back in a few minutes. But there's an episode, the beginning of the fifth season, where Walt's at the diner and he puts the 52 in the bacon. It's like that. Yeah. It's that, like, the flash forward, I guess, sort of thing. And then you don't catch up with that Walt until, like, the end of like the next season. Like, they shot that, or like not until, like, the end of the series. You know what I'm talking about?
Right. I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. And he puts a watch down or something on. Or he's wearing a watch, or he wasn't wearing a watch. There's something with a watch.
Okay.
And I need to research this. But basically, like, they didn't know that whole... And he's got, like, the shotguns in his trunk.
Yeah.
That was, like, something they did. And they had, like, a general idea. But they didn't have that figured out. So they had to kind of, after the fact, like, piece it together. And there was a part where he, like, took his... I guess he was wearing a watch. And they had him take it off and put it somewhere. Because in that flash-forward scene that they had done the season before, he wasn't wearing a watch. It was like something like that. So it was like those little details, like, oh, we can't do that.
Wow.
Yeah, so it is interesting, but that's like something you would only find out within like a special interview.
Yeah.
So, but I do think that in general, that when you don't have this like the network jumping down your throat being like, well, you need to pump out 22 mm-hmm. episodes of this show. Like, that's such a big commitment for people.
And yeah.
You need to have it. I really respect shows that are a good length that have a nice story arc and that never kind of falter or never have that downhill thing go. So
they never feel the need to jump the shark,
mm-hmm.
basically. Mm-hmm. Jumping quickly back to Transparent, without giving away any spoilers about the show or anything really in particular, what do you like about that show?
What do I like about that show? I mean, I like that all the characters on the show are interesting,
mm-hmm.
complex, and they're flawed, but they're like somewhat likable, at least in my view.
Yeah.
Because some people like hate certain characters. Where I don't necessarily hate anyone on that show. I think they do a really good job of making you feel compassionate for all the characters, for each one like individually, where I can sympathize with almost all of them.
Okay.
Even in like the littlest way.
Right.
You know, it's not perfect. Mm-hmm. Nothing's perfect, but I think they do a really good job of capturing that. And also, there's like some in some ways it hits home just because of like the Jewish family.
For some reason with the whole thing with the Jewish family, I for some reason got like an instant connection, or I'm just like, ooh, that seems pretty real.
Yeah, well it's like this really the one thing that's like a really big theme is like they're really tight knit, but almost too tight knit, and then they like make each other feel guilty.
Yeah,
they do that, and I'm like, that's very true. I'm like Jewish families.
Yeah. Well, the thing I notice about them is that they're like, I guess maybe a good example, because I would say they're definitely a dysfunctional family.
Yeah.
But in a different way, where did you watch Shameless?
Yes.
So I would also say they're a dysfunctional family, but I would say that they are each dysfunctional families in different ways.
Totally different ways.
Yeah. Yes. And I really like how in Transparent they're the way that they're dysfunctional, where you were kind of mentioning they're very kind of close and tight knit.
Yeah.
And oh my god, what is with all these trains and stuff?
Well, Shameless is a dysfunction that I can't relate to.
Right.
Yeah. You know,
I think maybe that's why.
To be honest. And maybe some people could.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas Transparent is a dysfunction I can relate to.
Yeah.
And they're so, obviously, I mean, you could say one is worse than the other,
mm-hmm.
but like they're very different though.
Yeah. And I think what's interesting is that each character does have their own flaws. Even Mona, which is played by Jeffrey Tambor, has, again, at this point, her own flaws. Because she, when as a father or as a parent, was kind of it's weird. Because as a parent, she was there for the children, but also not there for the children at the same time. Like she wasn't there for them as when they were growing up and as children, and she wasn't really there as when she was as a husband to the wife.
Mm.
So there was that missing. But as like a provider, she was there for them.
Right.
So there's that missing of the love part, but there's the financial part. And I feel like that...
That's very true.
Yeah, I feel like by substituting the money for the love, it helped ingrain this like sign of self and this entitlement that the children seem to all have, where like Jeffrey Tambor's character is going through this huge thing, and yet all the children are kind of focused in on their own crap. They don't give a shit.
Yeah, they're selfish.
Yeah,
they're all selfish, and that's, I mean, you could blame the parents, but it does make a lot of sense, mm-hmm. though, where the parents would throw money at the problem, and they do have that sense of entitlement where they feel like mm-hmm. they can get that from the
right.
parents, and yeah, they don't show as much compassion for each other.
Yeah, and definitely not for each other. And even though like Mona's going through this like huge moment in her life, like there's some heartbreaking moments where you're just like, oh my god, like these fucking kids, like just be there for your mother or your new mother, your father, just be there for him.
Yeah.
He's going through this. She is going through this new change, this new life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but everyone's focused on their own stuff, and also it affects. I can understand in a lot of ways because it's just you don't know how it's going to affect each of the children. Mm-hmm. It's it's a big thing, and in a way they take it like personally in a lot of ways. Yeah. But I think it's, I definitely recommend the show.
Absolutely.
I would say the one thing I would warn is don't listen to the Emmys, because I'm pretty sure Jeffrey Tambor won two times, which is great. I'm glad he won, but for best actor in a comedy series 2 years in a row.
Yeah.
And I think be very careful with that, because while there is some comedy in it, it is definitely more drama, I would say. So don't go into it thinking this is going to make me feel great.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, because it does leave you sometimes. I mean, it's good, but sometimes it does leave you with an uneasy feeling. Mm-hmm. So
yeah,
if you want like pure comedy, you know, go watch like The Office or something.
Yeah, I wouldn't watch this if you're just looking for comedy.
Watch the show Cheers. Cheers is on Netflix. It's a great show, and you know, I'm always gonna promote Cheers just as a show if you just want to kick back and relax. Cheers is a great one.
Speaking of Netflix, what either right now or in the past Netflix originals have you watched and like or dislike? Which ones have you seen and you're like, well, this was shit?
I mean, I think the few series that I've watched, mm-hmm. I've liked. The one that I want to like restart, get back into, is Lady Dynamite with Maria Bamford.
Oh, okay. I never watched that.
Yeah, which is the same guy who did Arrested Development. And I watched the first episode, and I want to like watch more. Mm-hmm. But it has very much that Arrested Development type of feel to it.
Okay.
So there's that one I want to watch. But, you know, we talked about Stranger Things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in the last episode. Which was great.
And I watched the show. Well, I watched Orange is the New Black.
Okay.
Which I've liked. I generally liked overall.
Mm-hmm.
I liked this last season a lot better than the one before it. The third season, I was not a huge fan of. I thought it was kind of silly. It got kind of uninteresting to me. Where I think this one, it got darker and they really picked it up.
Oh yeah, it got darker.
And it was good.
I think this one had like some of the it was definitely a little bit political. It definitely got to the like, a lot of the issues that are currently going on in like prisons and with like guards taking advantage of the prisoners and stuff like that. Like the prisoners, they made a mistake. They fucked up. Some people died. Some people got hurt. But like there's still people. Some people are in there to, I don't know, to change their life, make things better.
We don't. Yeah, we have a weird system of punishment. That's a whole nother discussion.
Yeah, that's
a
discussion. Maybe we shouldn't get into that. But yeah, I liked how it wasn't just like, I don't know, it wasn't just black and white. This season seemed more complex.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's another one. The show Love, the Judd Apatow show. Okay. I really liked.
You liked that? Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting, because I watched it as well, and I couldn't.
Couldn't get into it.
I couldn't get into it. I watched the whole thing, but like I think what bothered me, it was the whole like ugly guy, attractive female trope.
Well, that's
that whole thing.
That's like Judd Apatow's specialty,
yeah,
though.
Sure.
I mean, well, that's I mean, like that all his movies are like that.
That would be fine, but the biggest issue I had was that beyond the ugly guy, hot woman trope, it was ugly guy with shitty personality and hot girl.
Yeah, a lot of people didn't like him.
I feel like he had no redeeming qualities. He just seemed kind of like an ass. I just didn't like him at all.
I think that, you know, it's interesting. I think that's kind of what they were going for in a way. They didn't want to make it so... That's how I saw it. They didn't want to make it seem like so clear cut, because we've seen like, oh, the nice nerdy guy.
Right.
Like, and he's going to try and get the girl, and he gets the girl. Hooray. You know?
Right.
And he beats the bad guy. You know, it wasn't like that. They kind of turned it on its side a little bit.
I mean,
she was a little fucked up.
Yeah.
Although, I was like, I was with you though, because like, I was like on her side the whole time.
Yeah.
I was like, I was like rooting for her to like, yeah, get it together. And like, you're doing great. And then I actually, my favorite was her roommate, Birdie, was the best.
Oh, her roommate. I will give you, she was the best part.
She should
have her own thing.
Yeah, she was the best. But but yeah, his character was harder to get behind.
Yeah.
And in a little sad in some ways.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I kind of liked how it got me where it was kind of interesting. Where, yeah, he wasn't perfect and he kind of had like some like asshole type tendencies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I understand, but there's something about those kind of characters maybe that I kind of like because I kind of see because they're not like perfect because mm-hmm. they have issues. So yeah. That's just my own thing. Yeah, but I understand.
Did you see Master of None?
Mm-hmm.
What did you think of that one?
I thought that was okay.
Oh, okay, that's funny because I really liked that one.
Yeah.
And which is weird because I typically, no offense to Aziz, not that he's going to listen to this, but like I typically don't like his stand-up.
Yeah, me neither.
I just find it to be, I don't know, it just doesn't do it for me. But like, yeah. I felt like his comedy put into this medium worked really well.
No, it did.
Yeah, and I really enjoyed it. I thought it was just like, oh my God, this is like late people in their late 20s, early 30s, trying to figure out their life, trying to figure out their career, trying to figure out their relationships. Like, I was like, oh shit, like this is stuff we're dealing with now. Like, this is... I can get down with this.
Yeah, it still bothered me that he lived in, like, a decent apartment.
That always did bother me a little bit.
That always bugs me, but I guess that's, like, with every show. Yeah. I liked that Eric Wareheim was his friend, because he was really great.
Yeah.
I did like the show, like, overall. Mm-hmm. I think... But it wasn't, like, my favorite.
Okay, fair enough.
That's... I feel like it got, like, a lot of praise. Yeah. I feel like just people like Aziz and they like his comedy. But, sure. But also, he's very... He's political in a lot of ways, too.
Mm-hmm.
Where he kind of rubs people the wrong way.
All right.
So, again, he's not my favorite comedian, so it's kind of hard. There's, like, certain things, like, there were certain parts, certain episodes that I really liked, and there were some that just kind of seemed like, meh. But I would definitely watch it again.
Okay, nice. Yeah, I did like how he took the whole issue where, I heard somewhere in, like, an interview, and he was, like, trying to, like, really, like, push this out, and he's, like, he got, like, the whole thing from, like, the heads of whatever the production company is like, I don't know if this is going to really reach like mainstream media, which basically means I don't think white people are going to like this. And he's like, I'm dealing with like normal issues. White people have normal issues as well. Yeah. It doesn't matter what like what color we are. And I do like how they did address like an issue where, because he's trying to get like an acting job and how he has to go up against other Indian guys and they're all fighting for this quote-unquote very stereotypical Indian guy. He's like, why can't I just play myself with my normal voice? No, everybody wants the Apu kind of voice.
Yeah.
And I really liked it. I was like, oh, like, I not that I know anything about that, but I was like, all right, that's, you're shedding a light on something that like, yeah, that is a little ridiculous.
Well, yeah, I did like that too. Mm-hmm. And that's actually part of his like real life.
Yeah.
Because he never wants to be cast as like the token like Indian guy, like,
yeah,
not like the guy on like the Big Bang Theory or like,
sure, yeah,
he doesn't want to be that. He want like, that's not what he wants. He just happens to be Indian. That's
yeah,
kind of what exactly. That's like what it is. And I really respect that.
Yeah,
I like that.
I mean, maybe it's easier for you and I because we're in New York and it's like, this is like the every single type of person you could think of is here. And we're just so used to seeing all different types of people. So sure, have an Indian character be the main lead. Have a girl be the main lead. Have this be the main lead. That, like,
yeah,
just whatever. Just give us a good story. Entertain us.
It doesn't matter. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, so as far as Netflix, I feel like you and I, we watch that's at least for me, that's like my go-to source.
Yeah.
Where I'll look for stuff on there. If I'm not watching a show, I'll go and watch like comedy specials that are on there, because there's tons of comedy specials.
I know you dig BoJack Horseman.
BoJack is another
one. That's a great one.
That was an amazing show. Yeah. I highly recommend it.
Absolutely.
Again, another one where it's funny but also very dark.
So yeah.
Just beware.
That's a dark one. Speaking of dark, and I loved it. I believe we spoke about it. The Daredevil.
I haven't watched it yet.
You haven't watched it yet? No. Oh my God! You got to jump on that, man.
I know, I'm reluctant because of superheroes, but maybe I will.
I would definitely recommend it, especially because, I'd say for the most part, it's like kind of based in reality. There's not too much like, ooh, superpowers kind of.
Better than Batman, Superman?
Easily.
Yeah. Okay, so, I mean, that's another one. But we were talking before the podcast started that with Hulu, you and I, we kind of don't really watch too much on Hulu.
Yeah, I don't even know what original shows they have.
There's one with Billy Eichner. And there's one with Aaron Paul called The Path.
But okay.
Again, I haven't watched any of these shows because I have ads on Hulu. You have ads unless you pay extra. And that's like enough of a deterrent for me. And there's nothing there's nothing that interesting that I will watch on that like draws me to Hulu. I The one show I did watch for a little while was Community, was on Hulu.
Okay.
I watched that for a while. But yeah, I'm always, every month I'm always, when I get my Hulu bill, I'm like, do I really still need this? I don't really watch it that much.
Yeah.
So I don't know if I would put that on the same level. I think Hulu maybe is more for people who missed the show the night before. If they missed New Girl last night, New Girl, then they'll watch it on Hulu the next day. It seems to be more of that. I don't think it's going to go anywhere. But for me personally, it's just not my go-to source.
Nothing ever really drew me to it. Mm-hmm. I kind of felt the same way where, all right, maybe I missed an episode here of some show. Maybe it's on Hulu. I'll check.
Yeah.
And then most of the time, you have to pay for it, or it's just like the 30-second trailer for that episode. And I'm just like, well, great. That didn't help me at all.
Right. And now there's more services that are coming out, too. There's Full Screen is another one, which I don't know much about.
Oh, I didn't know.
And there's CISO, which is a comedy network.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
It has a lot of past like SNLs and like I think they have like Kids in the Hall. They have like all that stuff, and they have like their own original series.
Oh, cool.
I think one of them, which I really want to watch, is a show. It's with actually Paul F. Tompkins. It's called Bajillion Dollar Properties. It's like supposed to make fun of those shows.
Okay.
And it's just like a faux reality show. It's supposed to be really good.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, there's like stuff like that, which maybe we should check out and then maybe do another.
Oh yeah, another I'm totally podcast down. About I, that. I really like a lot of the things that Paul F. Tompkins does. I find him always funny.
He's brilliant. But I feel like there's more and more things coming out, more and more like networks or streaming platforms, whatever you want to call it, and that is slowly taking over.
Yeah.
And like I've said before, until they figure out how to do that with sports, it's over. I think that's like the missing link.
Yeah, if they figure out like some sort of like subscription thing, just sports,
like the NFL app.
Yeah.
That, or just like NFL something that just has every game, and you pay like $10 a month or something. It's like done. It's over.
That'd be pretty cool.
Yeah, I mean easy, but the problem with that is that they have all the networks have these contracts and stuff. So I think it would take a while. I mean, what they have now is you can stream it through like ESPN app and stuff.
And there's also like Red Zone or whatever on, but that's like through cable.
That's
and
like ADD football. I don't really like Red Zone.
I mean, typically I'll like be at like Brittany's house and like we'll be watching the Giant game, and then we'll just periodically when like they go to commercial at the Giant game, we'll just jump over to Red Zone.
Okay.
Just to see what else is going on. But our main focus is on the Giants.
Yeah. I don't touch the remote. I just kind of like, I get weird with that stuff where I don't like to do too many things at once.
Fair enough.
So I'll check my phone periodically for like fantasy football updates.
Okay.
But I do try and limit it, especially during football games. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I feel like that's like that is the missing piece of the puzzle.
It's interesting. Right there. So you're imagining like a future where we're just gonna do you imagine a future where we're just gonna completely go away from cable and all that stuff completely, or is it gonna be all streaming, or is it gonna be like a new version of cable where you can just pick the type of programming that you want?
Yeah, I think that is probably more where it's going to go. I can't see the cable companies just like
completely going away.
Yeah. No, and I think also too many people, especially nowadays, are still used to having that. Mm-hmm. You know, my own parents, they still like just flipping on the news or flipping through the channels. So I think that they will have, maybe they'll, I mean, they've done it more in recent years with just on-demand type stuff.
Right.
But even that is kind of silly, where I think it's not done perfectly.
Okay.
You know, there's just a lot of flaws with that, too.
I agree.
So I think you're right. I think they will have some kind of, like, service where it's just kind of, like, you pick what you want to watch. Like, they'll have it out there.
I don't know why they don't do that now. It just makes sense.
Like, you turn on the TV, and there's just, like, a bunch of little icons, like, watch.
Yeah.
Watch nightly news with Lester.
Right.
Or
even like, oh, I always watch these specific channels.
Mm-hmm.
Just give me these channels. I don't need extra channels.
Well, yeah, or yeah, pay what you want to pay for. I mean, I think probably what it would do would maybe break. They would probably have some kind of package though, where I don't see them like individual channels. Maybe. But I feel like the cable companies would not like that.
Right.
You would need to get... They would have to package it somehow.
Yeah,
still.
I wonder if they could do something like, I typically like sports, action, and comedy. So let me get this package. It just comes with sports, action, and comedy channels.
I think what'll happen is slowly they'll start to modify. There won't be like a bazillion channels anymore. Mm-hmm. Well, they'll start to group things together or just be specific types of shows. Because I really don't know what's like on channels anymore. Like I just don't know. And I don't look. I'm like, I have to look through like a guide and see what time when this starts. What kind of bullshit is that? Like, I just want to pick a movie and start it. And there's things you can't do with that. Like, you can find, you go to Netflix, you go to Hulu or Amazon or whatever. Mm-hmm. You find something weird. Like, you read descriptions for things.
Yeah.
The other night, I was with a friend and we watched the movie The Phantom.
Okay.
I don't know if you've ever seen it.
Is that the... I think I'm thinking of the wrong thing, but is that the one movie with, oh my God, what the hell's the guy's name?
I'm going to wait for you to say it because I think he might be onto it.
He's from Titanic?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Should I tell?
And he's also, oh my God, hold on. Billy Zane.
Yes. It's The Phantom is a superhero movie starring Billy Zane, and it is fantastic. So
that's amazing.
So like I read the description and we were just like, we should watch this.
Yeah.
You know? And it's super campy. A lot of it's pretty cheesy and like some of it's really funny. And also I'm not gonna lie, it's super entertaining. It's a very there's not a dull moment in that movie. It's a very entertaining movie. But like you wouldn't stumble upon that on like HBO or something.
No.
You know? I mean not HBO, fucking TNT.
TNT, yeah.
So there's stuff like that where I'm like, yeah, like I'm glad I was able to watch this movie from 1996.
Oh my God, I can't believe that. That's so great.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing that's really great about these kind of streaming services is that with like cable, you have to, I can't think of any type that doesn't require it, but you pretty much have to have like a cable box from the cable company.
Yeah.
You want to have, I think you have to pay, like it's an extra charge depending on how many you have in your house or whatever. Yeah. With streaming, it's easy. It's so much easier. You just either you have like a Chromecast, you have you can play something through your Xbox or your PlayStation. You could get a the Amazon Fire Stick or whatever.
Yeah,
there's just so it's the Roku.
Yeah, that's
Apple
what I got,
TV
the Roku box, and it's been I never had an issue with it. It's great.
All those things it makes it so much easier than dealing with cable companies and those boxes and everything.
And with the Roku, what's great is, well, first of all, I love that the remote has a headphone jack.
Mm-hmm.
Because you don't have to wake up anybody.
Oh yeah,
which is great if you're watching something late at night. But also, you can there's an app on your phone you can get that's a remote for it.
Oh really?
So if you happen to lose the remote, you have your phone.
Oh wow, that's
and
pretty cool.
You just pull
out
the remote there. So yeah, they make losing the remote more difficult.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Today's episode is brought to you by Roku.
No. Roku.
It's not really though. But we'll take your money though.
If you like.
Have you seen the show The Man in the High Castle?
Mm-mm.
So that's on Amazon Prime.
Yeah.
And I like fell in love with it instantly. It is so good.
I've heard about
it. I really recommend it. I don't want to give any spoilers away, but I'll give like the basic premise that you could, if you were looking it up, you go, oh, that's what it's about. It's like a dystopian America, basically, mm-hmm. where the Nazis won World War II.
Yeah.
So you and I are not here.
Yeah. We are dead.
Oh, well, we never even had a chance. But basically, it's... so the U.S. is split up into three parts. You have the west of the Rocky Mountains is the Japanese state.
Mm-hmm.
And the eastern board of the country is the Nazi state. Mm-hmm. And then right in the middle is kind of like this no man's land of like a neutral zone, if you will. And it's really well done. There's basically a resistance, and then the main characters are either part of the resistance or part of the quote unquote bad guys, the Nazis or the Japanese guys who are on like in California in that area. And it's so well written and really well done. And there's areas where you're like, you're not sure who's on what side and who's a good guy, who's a bad guy. And it's really weird because there's moments where you're like rooting for a character. And then you go like, wait a minute, he's a Nazi. I'm rooting for a Nazi. And then in no way is this like sympathetic to the Nazi cause at all. But it's like, it takes on this type of universe in a realistic way where certain characters are born into it because it takes place in the 60s. So certain...
Okay, so a couple decades after.
A couple decades after this whole thing. So there's certain characters who are just born into this. They don't know anything different.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they're just... So, like, you're born. You're a Nazi now. But, like, you didn't have a choice. You grew up... And there's other characters where it's like, all right, you're a Nazi, but that other Nazi is, like, a bajillion times worse than you are.
Yeah.
So, like, I'm going to kind of root for you, but in the back of my head, I'm just like, no, you're an evil person.
Yeah.
But that, it's like, it's super, like, really cool, and there's like a sort of sci-fi element, but it's not really like the most, like, super important.
Okay.
It's more about I don't know, these characters, and they're on a mission to basically bring these reels of film to this quote unquote man in the high castle. That's all you really know. The rebels are trying to bring this film to the man in the high castle.
And is it based off of a book too?
It is based off a book.
Okay.
And the whole show starts out like brilliantly. They use, have you ever seen, The Sound of Music?
Yeah.
Which for some reason I've never seen.
You should see it.
I should see it.
I have it on VHS. Oh. That won't help you.
That's not going to help me. but yeah. So the Edelweiss song.
Yeah.
And they have it sung by this, like, I guess, young woman. And the way that it did, I don't know, the way they recorded it is so kind of eerie.
Yeah,
it's really weird. And you know what the best way to describe the whole thing? There's an episode where one of the characters goes to visit a military character in his home on Long Island.
Ooh.
And they're celebrating like VD Day, I believe. It's like Victory Day.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the Victory Day of the Nazis when the U.S. surrendered.
Yeah. Okay.
So they're going down the street, and the U.S. flag has been changed slightly. So they're going down the street. And there's flags out everywhere, all over people's fences and their little awnings and this and that. And each flag has red, white, and blue.
Mm-hmm.
And right in the center are swastikas.
Wow.
And it is the most eerie looking thing as this guy sitting in a car driving down the block.
Yeah.
Which is just American flags with swastikas on it. And it was like super creepy. Yeah, exactly. But I really, really recommend this show. It's so good.
I'm going to watch this after I finish Transparent now, because this sounds really good.
Definitely. It's so good. It's weird, but it's great.
I like weird stuff like that, though. And I don't go by critics either. I decided that I don't like to go by the critically acclaimed stuff.
Okay.
I just kind of like to form my own opinions. Like, the way you just sold that to me, it just sounds like a really interesting concept.
Yeah.
And that's all I need. All
right.
And that's really important.
The show is brought to you by The Man in the High
Castle. Watch The Man in the High Castle on Amazon Prime. Yeah, so I think generally you and I would both agree that we like streaming services,
yeah,
and that's where we watch all, most if not all of our content.
Pretty much.
I have no time for appointment viewing.
Yeah.
No time for that. No. I watch football at certain times.
Yeah, that's pretty much, that's the only thing.
Although, you know what's nice? If you DVR, if you have a DVR,
yeah,
you can DVR the game and then cut out like an hour, because you can, like, you start, like, let's say the game starts at 1.
Okay.
DVR it and then start watching it at 2.
Okay.
And then you go and
you can quickly
and you catch up. You go through, you breeze through the commercials, and then you eventually catch up. So you actually cut out like an hour of your, like, you'll, like, by the end of it, by the end of it, you're all caught up.
I feel like I'd be too nervous worrying, it would get spoiled.
Put your phone away, put your computer away.
I would have to, because especially if you're checking up on fantasy or something like that.
Yeah, but think about how much you could get done, though, like, in that hour.
That is true.
You could go to
yoga
class.
You might have something here, man. Oh, yeah. All that yoga that I'm missing out on.
Yeah, yeah, so there's that. So, yeah, I think we pretty much covered everything we wanted to, right?
Absolutely.
Feel good about it?
Yeah, that was
fun. So go out, watch Man in the High Castle, now on Amazon Prime.
Yeah.
And watch anything, watch any
watch
show.
Watch Transparent?
Yeah, just go through. There's plenty of options.
Orange is the New Black?
If you don't have it, if you, at least, if nothing else, get a Netflix subscription. It costs
$10. Or find somebody that has one and... use their
Use theirs or split it with somebody. Yeah. You know, figure it out.
Call
you
up Netflix. Get them to put Doctor Who back on Netflix. I miss it.
Sign a petition.
And then get somebody get that started.
We'll do it.
That's why we need to get an intern.
Yeah.
just for that.
That'll be our next thing. We'll get right on that.
Yeah.
All right, well, that's it, all right? Thanks for joining us, guys, and tune in for our next episode.
Peace.